Good morning. Our first song that I chose, I'd like it to help us lead us into the heart of worship. We're going to sing it a little slower than we normally do, and that's just to help us really think of the words that we are singing this morning. So please stand, and we're going to sing, "I Have Decided to Follow Jesus."
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The world behind I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there's peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. Dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus, 'cause your name is power, your name is healing, your name. Break every stronghold, shine through. know Jesus from the mountains, and Jesus in the streets, and Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains, and Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains, and Jesus in the streets, and Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, and Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. 'Cause your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows.
Today is Romans 1:19 and 20. They know the truth about God because he has made it obvious to them. For ever since the world was created, people have seen the earth and sky. Through everything God made, they can clearly see his invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature. So they have no excuse for not knowing God. Our next song is a reminder to look for all the things that God has blessed us with in our everyday lives through his creation. Thank you.
Zach led last week, and for an older song that we've sung multiple times in youth, the words resonated with me. How often are we asking for something from God? And this song is just it's reminding us that God's grace is enough, and that's all we need, that it is enough.
Great is your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinner's restless heart. You lead us by still waters into mercy. And nothing can keep us apart. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, O God. And your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough for me. God of Jacob, you use the weak to lead the strong. You lead us in the song of your salvation, and all your people sing along. So remember your children, remember
Just a little tidying up here before we get started. Exciting stuff. New conference pastor, I'm sure. Bishop, we call him. I guess we should be continuing to be in prayer for that. Lots of challenges as they transition. And blessings upon Bishop Dave as he moves on to his new role. Money, 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 always sunny in a rich man's world. Pastor George set a standard last week singing in his sermon. It seemed. Does anybody recognize that tune? Did I sing more of it? Or did you what do you got? Who is it? ABBA, from a song called Money, Money. ABBA's good stuff. If you don't listen to ABBA, you really should. Although, interestingly enough, my kids grew up listening to the ABBA Gold CD lots in the car. This was back when there were CD players in cars. And poor Amariah was 5 years old singing that song. And I thought to myself, do you know what that song is about? It's about some lady who's tired of not having enough money, and so she hatches a plan. She's going to go and find herself a rich man and marry a rich man so that she can be rich. But then she goes, but I'm not really that great of a catch. I'm paraphrasing a little bit. So instead, she's going to go to Las Vegas or Monaco, and she's going to win it in some kind of gambling scheme. Her plan is to get rich. I think the song is probably tongue-in-cheek, but is it? There have been plenty of people who have had similar plans. Maybe not those exact plans, but the desire to get rich burns strong in probably most of us if we're not careful with it. People have done far worse than try to find a rich man or try to win at the laundry, at the lottery. Maybe it's like the laundry too. Freudian slip. According to the Made in Canada website, February of 2023, and I checked a bunch of other places to see if these statistics were accurate, and they were very consistent. The average Canadian household debt, not including a mortgage, is over $41,000. That assumes two adults in the home, two adults, $41,000. So that breaks down to over $20,000 of debt, the average Canadian adult, apart from their mortgage. That's a big number. The news got worse for me as I looked at the 46 to 55-year-old category, of which I sit squarely in the middle of. In the 46 to 55-year-old category, the debt is 70% higher than that in the household. It's over $36,000 for one person and over $75,000 for two people. Non-mortgage debt. I was trying to rack my brain. Who's got that kind of debt? I don't, which means that I must bring the average down. But some people do. Money is a dangerous thing. It can be a dangerous thing. So I'm going to ask you this question. How are you at managing money? Are you wise with money? Or are you a fool with money? Will Rogers summed it up well when he said it like this. The trouble is that too many people are spending money they don't have for things they don't need in order to impress people they don't even like. That's a challenge with money. You see, when it comes to money, I think that there are way more of us that are fools than would care to admit. I suspect if we were to lay the books open, we would go, oops, I don't really want people to see how I have been managing money. Not everyone, I'm sure there are, and maybe we bring the average way down here as a church. Maybe everyone in this room is gloriously great at handling and managing money. Maybe all of us would, according to what God's word says, are very, very wise with our money. I'd hope that would be true, and I pray that it is. But my desire is that we would grow in that through our study of God's word. Look, my intention this morning is not to kick your derriere if you haven't done altogether wisely with money. None of us have been perfect with how we have managed our money. Rather, I want us to learn together. You can imagine, as I was studying this topic this week, I was encouraged, you might say convicted, of a few places in my life where I haven't been managing money in a way that is consistent with God's word. And I suspect that that could happen to all of us as we study together. But I'm going to ask you to do something before we dive in. Would you be willing put your defenses aside for a moment and just listen to what God's word says about money, about the foolish handling of it, about the wise handling of it, and about how we can be godly with the money that God has given us? Would you be willing to do that for a few minutes to listen to what God's word has to say about money? I'm looking for some head nods to see if you're with me. Because if you're not with me, then I should go sit down. Because we want to learn from God's word, and I think we could all hopefully be humble enough to recognize that we're not perfect, and there's room for all of us to grow. Amen? Thank you for that, amen, even if I have to prompt it myself. First of all, by the way, and I've organized my thoughts in three categories this morning, if you're taking notes. I don't know how many people take notes in this church. Who takes notes? Anybody take notes? Oh, Jody, thank you for you. Yeah. Addie, your mother's a good lady. You should grow up to be like her. That'd be good. If you're taking notes, you've got three categories for your notes this morning. The first category is, and I've written them all as questions. Are you foolishly greedy? That's the first. Are you foolishly greedy? The second is, are you wisely content? Are you wisely content? And the third is, are you righteously generous? Foolishly greedy, wisely content, righteously generous. You see, the problem with money is not money in and of itself. The paper itself or the coins are inanimate objects. They have an assigned value based upon what the culture, the group of people have agreed to together to work with. The money itself is not a thing. It doesn't have any real value in and of itself. It's not worth the paper it's printed on. Perhaps you've heard that saying before. The problem is not with money. The problem is how badly we want it. Now, we need money, so we got to be careful. It's not a bad thing to gain money. But how badly we want money is the issue. Sometimes that's referred to as greed. Augustine of Hippo says it this way. It's not a matter of possession, but of desire. One man may have much money on him, but no greed in him. Whereas another man may have no money on him, but much greed in him. It's an attitude. It's the way we think. It's kind of a heart attitude of what we perceive about money, how badly we want it, and how badly we want more. And sadly thing is that generally speaking, as people get more money, it doesn't satisfy their greed. They want more money and more money. I don't know if that's ever happened to you, but I've experienced that at times in my life. Now, we're going to look at the Proverbs this morning specifically, but one word about Proverbs before we dive in. Proverbs are not promises. I just want you to understand that, because too many people have been hurt and have misunderstood Scripture when they've taken the Proverbs to be promises. I heard one well-meaning pastor one time say, in quoting of Proverbs 22:6, who knows what Proverbs 22:6 says? Anyone? Come on, church, someone knows it. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he's old, he will not depart from it. I wish I could tell you that that was a promise. But it's not. You can raise your children well in the Word of God, but they will all, as they become adults, make their own decisions and go their own direction. Now, is it generally true that if we train children well, that they'll go well? Yes, generally true, and that's what Proverbs are. They are wise sayings that are generally true, but they are not promises. If you're a fast flipper, go to the book of Proverbs. I'm not even going to flip through these so fast. I put them in my notes because there's so many of them. But if you want to try it, I'll always give you the reference. Proverbs. Are you there? I'm waiting for you. Some of you have devices, so you can flip even faster. We're going to look at probably 20 or 30 different Proverbs today. Proverbs chapter 15, verse 27 to start out with. Proverbs 15, 27, a greedy man brings trouble to his family, but he who hates bribes will live. Now, I'm going to ask you for congregational participation a few times over the course of this message, so I'm preparing you now in advance so you can be ready. With ready to share. According to this proverb, a greedy man brings trouble to his family. That is a wise saying that is generally true. Why do you think a greedy man, or maybe I should say, how do you think a greedy man might bring trouble to his family? Anybody? Okay, so he might actually desire his money more than his family. Yeah, that would bring trouble to the family, wouldn't it? Yeah. Other thoughts? Become a workaholic in order to get more money, which in turn would be very harmful for his family. Ask my children, they know a little bit about that. The desire for money can bring trouble to your family. Who would want to bring trouble to their family purposefully? None of us would. Proverbs 28, verse 20, if you're going to try and keep up. Proverbs 28, verse 20. A faithful man will be richly blessed, but one eager to get rich will not go unpunished. How would a man who's eager to get rich face trouble or not go unpunished? What could happen? What are some of the things that could happen to one who is eager to get rich? Anyone? Okay, neglecting real priorities. Good. Yes? You could call 911. I'm not entirely sure how I'm going to connect that one to money. If you have an idea, let me know. I know of a man who was eager to get rich. He had an investment opportunity that if he would have been paying a little more close attention, he would have recognized that it was probably a bit shady. You know what they say if it's too good to be true? And he lost $75,000. He invested all of his savings, and he lost it all. He was eager to get rich. Proverbs 28, verse 22. You only have to move ahead two verses for this one. Proverbs 28, 22. A stingy man is eager to get rich and is unaware that poverty awaits him. Now, this is looking at things from a totally different side. It's not the desire to get rich, but rather the eagerness to keep the riches, to hold them tightly. And it says here that a stingy man who is eager to get rich and is unaware that poverty awaits him. Proverbs 28, 25, a few more verses ahead. A greedy man stirs up dissension, but he who trusts in the Lord will prosper. As we're looking at these proverbs, we're seeing very clearly that there is money or the desire for it, the unhealthy desire for it, in contrast to all of these other things that are neglected, that fall to ruin, that come into trouble. Money is compared and contrasted. And in this particular verse, instead of desiring money, one should rather trust whom? Say it out loud. I've got really bad hearing. I'm getting old. The Lord. Thank you very much. And this is the biggest contrast. Do you trust in the money or do you trust in the Lord? And lots of us would very quickly say, oh, no, we trust in the Lord. Yeah, we trust in the Lord. And then I would say, but what do your actions show? What are your words and your attitudes and the way that you spend your time? What does that show? Does that show that you trust in the Lord? Perhaps it does. And praise Him if that's the case. But perhaps your time and your effort and your energies are much more focused on getting more money. Proverbs 18:11. The wealth of the rich is their fortified city. They imagine it an unscalable wall. They're trusting in riches. Pastor Ron talked about this 2 weeks ago. I think he might have even used this verse exactly. The wealth of the rich is their fortified city. They imagine it an unscalable wall. Now, nobody would say that out loud. Nobody looks at their retirement account balance and says, I'm good. Well, actually, don't we? I'm young and haven't retired yet. I look at my retirement balance all the time. I don't know how it's been for you. I'm sort of talking to the retired folks here. That's why I'm over. You notice I got a little closer to you all of a sudden. I'm ready to jump. If you've been paying attention, and you have to because you live off it. I understand that. But if you look at your retirement balance and it's good and solid and you feel comfortable and good about yourself, that's a bit of a scary spot. Easy come, easy go. I remember back in 2008 was the first time I had some retirement built up. It wasn't a large number. But in a swoosh, 25% of my retirement was gone. And I was reminded, where should my trust lie? Not in my retirement fund. And if you've been paying any attention to the retirement fund lines and the investment accounts and the mutual funds in the last couple of years, they've been doing a whole lot of this. That's a scary way to live if that's what you depend upon. Ultimately, the person who is greedy desires or loves money more than they love God. Now, no one would ever say that out loud. I've never heard one church or Christian person say, I love money more than I love God. And yet it might be what we really think down in our heart. Another song, I won't sing this one for you, but it was written by a band called Extreme in 1990. They're the ones that sang that song, More Than Words, wedding song used years ago. Saying I love... No, I wasn't going to sing. Right, okay. They wrote a song called Money, In God We Trust. Here, I'll give you some of the lyrics. Hallelujah. Now I lay me down to sleep. Hallelujah, almighty dollar. I pray the Lord afford my roll to keep. Hallelujah, almighty dollar. Money. I need more money. Just a little more money. I said I need more money. Yeah, yeah. And give us these days our daily bread. Only you we praise, almighty dollar. Money. My personal savior. Money. Oh, material lover. Money. Life's only treasure. Money. Yeah, in God we trust. And this is a satirical song. They're not really worshiping money, but that's the way that it's written. And they end with an interesting line that I find fascinating. In the United States, it says on the top of their bills, does anybody know? In God we trust. And they started that in 1956. It's actually not that old. It was on their coins for almost 100 years before that. But only in 1956 was it passed that would be on their dollar bills. In God we trust. In an effort to remind them as they were holding the money that this isn't really what we trust. Actually, we trust in... Thank you for filling in there. That's good. And that's the challenge. Money. We need more money. Just a little more money. Yeah, yeah. Money. In God we trust. I suspect that's the constant tension in our hearts, whether we would acknowledge it or not. So again, I ask you the question, and I want you to consider it carefully. And this one, by the way, I don't want you to answer out loud. Do you love money? Do you love money more than you love God? I don't want you to be offended by that question. I just want you to think about it carefully. Do you love money more than you love God? In 1 Timothy chapter 6, and 9 and 10, for those of you that are flipping fast. 1 Timothy 6, 9 and 10. And we're going to come back to these verses a little bit more later. But it says this, people who want to get rich fall into a temptation and a trap, and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge men into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil, and some people who are eager for money have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. Over the many years of working in a church, I have watched as people sometimes have fallen away from the church. And most of them didn't say, you know what, I hate God, and I don't want anything to do with the church. There were a few of those. Most of them fell away because they started to work on Sunday or whatever. Now, I know that in our culture, it's different than it used to be, and some of us have to work Sundays. I understand that. But people don't just all of a sudden declare, money's more important to me, but rather their lifestyle choices show that day by day, that money is more important. They're greedy for money. They want to have a little bit more money. And as a result of that, they fall into a trap. They plunge into ruin and destruction. Once again, it's not money that's the problem. It's how eager we are for money and how dangerous that way of thinking can be. Now, according to Proverbs, there's a bunch of things that are better than money, not just trusting in God, and we're going to get to that in a bit, but there's a few other ways of thinking about money or contrasting money. So again, flipping back to Proverbs in verse 15, I'm sorry, in chapter 15, verse 16. Proverbs 15, 16. Better a little with the fear of the Lord than great wealth with turmoil. Better a little with the fear of the Lord. In the Proverbs and elsewhere in Scripture, it says over and over and over again, the beginning of wisdom or the beginning of knowledge is what? The fear of the Lord. What does that mean? That means a proper acknowledgement about who God is and who we are. That is more important than having lots of stuff. There are people with great amounts of wealth, and you can tell by the way that they live that they do not fear the Lord. That is not a household that you would want to be a part of. Those are the ones that are on TV and in social media, and everything looks good on the outside until the scandal hits. Better a little with the fear of the Lord than great wealth with turmoil. And some of you that have turmoil in your homes, you probably would say amen to that, but probably not so out loud right here. And then wisdom instruction, Proverbs 8, 10, and 11. Proverbs 8, 10, and 11. Choose my instruction instead of silver, knowledge rather than choice gold. For wisdom is more precious than rubies, and nothing you desire can compare with her. Wisdom is more important than money, according to this. And we know the story of Solomon, who probably wrote these words. He started off well, didn't he? God asked him, what do you want? And he said, I want all the money I can take. Nope. He said, give me wisdom. And he started off well. And then guess what happened? God blessed him. And God does that. He's so gracious to us. And Solomon, as he was blessed, and as he grew in wisdom and in favor and in stature, he accumulated more things, more money. And by the end of his life, he wouldn't have prayed the same prayer. By the end of his life, we don't know if he's walking with the Lord today or not. We don't know the answer to that. But by the end of his life, he was clearly loving money more than he was loving God. And not just money, but the things of this world. Proverbs 8, verse 19. My fruit is better than fine gold. What I yield surpasses choice silver. And that's wisdom speaking. And Proverbs often speak from the wisdom's perspective. My fruit is better than fine gold. What I yield surpasses choice silver. And then Proverbs 16, 16. How much better to get wisdom than gold, to get insight rather than silver. So I'm going to ask you a question. Do you guys desire wisdom and insight? And if you do, there's a place to go to find it. You don't have to work super hard for it. In today's day and age, you've got it on your device in 57 different English versions. Wisdom and knowledge, it's in here. That's where we find it. So read it and study it and be immersed in it and watch as God through his Spirit increases your wisdom and will help you with how you manage money. And he will probably teach you contentment, which we'll get to in a minute. I don't want to get ahead of myself. Proverbs 16, verse 8. Better a little with righteousness than much gain with injustice. The fear of the Lord is better than money. Wisdom and instruction are far more valuable than money. And righteousness is significantly more valuable than money. Better a little with righteousness than much gain with injustice. Proverbs 10, verse 2 says this. Proverbs 10, 2. Ill-gotten treasures have no lasting value, but righteousness delivers from death. In Proverbs 11, 28, whoever trusts in his riches will fall, but the righteous will thrive like a green leaf. And Proverbs 11, 4, wealth is worthless on the day of wrath, but righteousness delivers from death. There may be some people who on the day of judgment are going to stand before God and say, hold on a second, God, let me produce to you my bank balance or my mutual fund account. Look at how much I have. Look at how great I am. Do you think anyone will actually do that? I don't know. But there are plenty of people living today like that's might they might think might be the case. And you're going to stand before God and say, God, here I am. Let me in. I'm great. I'm awesome. I've got all of this. Look what I've done. And God's going to say probably those words that Jesus quoted right in the New Testament, depart from me. I don't know you. When I stand before God and he looks at me and says, the judgment has come for you, Matthew, I'm hoping that you're going to say something similar to what I'm going to say. I've got nothing, God, but the righteousness of Jesus Christ that I've been clothed with because of what he has done for me. See, righteousness from Christ can save you, but money cannot. And people say, well, money can buy you friends and money can do this. Yeah, there are some things that money can do. There's no doubt about it. You got more money, there's some blessings in that, and I think we should thank God if he gives it to us. There's some places where you can get ahead if you've got money, but when it comes to what matters, money doesn't matter. Do you understand that? Money can't do anything for you for what really matters. Righteousness. Righteousness. I wrote this in my notes. Money can't make you holy. Money can't make you wise. Money can't save you from your sins. Money can't make you righteous. Do you know why Jesus said in the New Testament that it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven? It's because money can't save you. That's it. You're literally better off to be completely broke and poor and have nothing with the righteousness of Christ. It's not even a comparison than being one of the third richest men in the world, whoever they are these days. So I'm going to ask you this question. Are you greedy? And according to Proverbs and Scripture, are you foolishly greedy? Don't answer that out loud. Think about it in your own heart. Are you wisely content? John MacArthur says this, the antidote for covetousness is contentment. Pastors like their alliterations. the antidote for covetousness, greed, the desire for things, the wanting of things. The antidote for that is to be content with what you already have. But content with what you have. Proverbs 17, verse 1. Let's look. Proverbs 17, verse 1. Better a dry crust with peace and quiet than a house full of feasting with strife. Some of the mothers with little children are saying amen in their hearts. I'd rather have a crust with some peace and quiet than a house full of feasting with strife. Wouldn't we say amen to that? Wouldn't we prefer that? Proverbs 23, verses 4 and 5. Proverbs 23, 4 and 5. Do not wear yourself out to get rich. That sounds like the workaholic thing. Do not wear yourself out to get rich. Have the wisdom to show restraint. Cast but a glance at riches, and they are gone, for they will surely sprout wings and fly off to the sky like an eagle. This is a verse Lorraine put in the bulletin for this morning, and isn't that something else? Do not wear yourself out to get rich. Have the wisdom to show restraint. Cast but a glance at riches, and they are gone, for they will surely sprout wings and fly off to the sky like an eagle. When we die, how much of the money we've made will we take with us? You young people over here. Uncle Mark knows the answer, but what about you guys? Probably is half of your uncle, so probably right about that. How much money are we going to take with us when we die? Zip, zilch, nada. You've probably seen the bumper sticker of the t-shirt, "He who dies with the most toys wins." But then I saw another one that said, "He who dies with the most toys still dies." You can't take any of it with you. That's the reality of it. Why would we waste our whole lives working for something that we can't take with us? Jesus said that we should rather store for ourselves up treasures where? In heaven, right? Where thief and won't come and steal and moth and rust aren't going to destroy. All this effort to get more money, to store it up for what? Now, I'm not suggesting to you, by the way, that there's anything sinful about having money. Inherently, there isn't. If you use what God has given you to bless others and to be more generous, praise the Lord. We're going to get to righteously generous in a few minutes. But if that's the desire of your heart, if that's what's driving you, if that's how you make your decisions, if that's what your focus and your attention is, if that's what matters to you, then according to Scripture, you are foolishly greedy and not wisely content. Here's one, Proverbs 25, 16. If you find honey, eat just enough, too much of it, and you will vomit. I love that one. And it's not specifically about money, but it could easily have said money instead of honey. It could easily have read, if you find honey, take just enough, too much of it, and you will vomit. And there would be truth to that. Be more of a metaphorical vomit, perhaps. Jeremiah Burroughs says it this way, "So this is the art of contentment, not to seek to add to our conditions, but to subtract from our desires." Did you catch that? And I think that just captures it. Instead of trying to get more and get more and get more, we should desire less and desire less and desire less. And trust Jesus and have our attention and our focus on Him and what He provides and what He brings and on His Word. You will find that those desires fade as you focus on what you can be content with that God has brought to you. Contentment also includes thankfulness, by the way. Now, we're not going to spend a whole lot of time talking about being grateful or thankful. But if you're not a grateful and thankful person, I can say probably without any kind of compromise that you are probably not content. So here's a real actionable item for you to work towards being contentment. Choose to be grateful and thankful for what you have. And make a habit of that. Make that a focus of your attention. To be thankful and grateful for what you do have. Because as you're focusing on that, your mind is not on all the things that you don't have that you want. And I found this quote by Charles Dickens. I didn't put it in, but I'm going to give it to you anyway. Because he said something along the lines of contentment is the great beautifier of the human spirit. And it actually keeps you from looking old. Now, whether that's true or not, I don't know. Ladies, decide that. That's more important for ladies because us guys, we can look grizzled and ugly and it doesn't matter so much as we get older. The point there is that being content And being thankful and being grateful is a beautiful quality. So it's not just about the focus of contentment, but there's benefits that go beyond, is what I'm trying to say. All right, let's flip over to the New Testament, to the book of Hebrews for a moment. Hebrews chapter 13. The question was asked, what does God say about money? And we are answering that by looking at Scripture, predominantly in Proverbs, but elsewhere as well, to see how they all work together and give a consistent message. Hebrews 13, verses 5 and 6. Keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have, because God has said, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. So we say with confidence. So we say with confidence, the Lord is my helper, I will not be afraid. What can man do to me? Isn't that something? Hebrews is consistent with Proverbs. Keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have. Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. What do you have, according to this? God is saying, you've got me. You've got me. And who's going to take care of you? Is your retirement account going to take care of you? Who's going to take care of you? God's going to take care of you. God is the one who will take care of you. Elsewhere in Scripture, it says that God owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. How many cattle do you think that is? What percentage of the cattle of this world do you think God owns? Let me ask you that way. Anybody? What percentage of the cattle do you think God owns? 100%. Yep, 100%. Yep. And every good thing that you have, Pastor George talked about this last Sunday, the ability that you have to do work, the strength in your body and your bones to do it, the mental capacity to manage those things, all of that comes from where? From God. He's the one that's given it to you. So fools, I called you fools. I shouldn't really do that. Don't be foolish. And by the way, I'm speaking to myself. Don't be foolish. God's already taking care of you. Do you think he needs your help? Like if you work really hard, then he'll take better care of you? Now, there is a place for working hard, and we're not talking about that in today's message. But who's the one taking care of you? Do you trust him to take care of you? Ultimately, this comes down to trust, doesn't it? Pastor Zach's going to cover that next Sunday, so I don't want to steal from his thunder. Proverbs 30, verses 7 to 9. Two things I ask of you, O Lord. Do not refuse me before I die. Keep falsehood and lies far from me. Give me neither poverty nor riches, but give me only my daily bread. Oh, no, I'd like some riches, please, Lord. I was adding my own interjection into there, by the way, in case you were wondering. Verse 9, otherwise I may have too much and disown you and say, who is the Lord? Or I may become poor and steal and so dishonor the name of my God. Isn't that a great couple of verses? Contentment. Two things I ask of you, Lord. Do not refuse me before I die. Keep falsehood and lies far from me. That's the first part. The second part is, give me neither poverty nor riches, but give me only my daily bread. Otherwise, I may have too much and disown you and say, who is the Lord? Otherwise, I may have too much and choose to trust in myself or my own riches or my own abilities. Don't give me too little, because then I might be tempted to steal and break laws and do other criminal things in order to get what I need. Give me just enough. I wonder how many of us pray that. I'm not asking you to answer out loud at this moment. I don't think that I pray the Lord's Prayer, give us this day our daily bread. And I've often thought about it in the light of food, but with the extreme song that referred to daily bread a little bit differently, I'm thinking there's an application there as well. Our daily bread is not just food. It's our provision for the day, what we need. And I wonder if I've thought about that as I've been saying the Lord's Prayer. I don't know that I have, and I need to think that way. Because that's the kind of attitude and heart that I want to have before the Lord. Lord, give me what I need today. And remove from me the desire to get so much more. I'd probably just hoard it and waste it anyway. Contentment. All right, let's turn together to 1 Timothy 6. I'm fastly running out of time, but that's okay because lunch is here today. And I love it how Pastor Ron always schedules me when we're having lunch together. He knows what I'm going to do. In 1 Timothy chapter 6, turn there with me for just a moment. 1 Timothy chapter 6. We read some earlier verses, but here let's start with verse 6. 1 Timothy 6, verse 6. But godliness with contentment is what? It's great gain. Yeah. Godliness with contentment. Do you know what's great gain? Isn't that kind of ironic that the word gain is used there? Paul uses a financial term of increase, but he doesn't relate it with getting more. He relates it with having less. He relates it with being content with what you have. And that's what Paul says. That's actually the greatest gain, not gaining more money, but gaining more contentment. How many of us spend any time every day praying and asking God to help us to be content? That'd be a great practice, wouldn't it? Lord, help me today to be content, which probably is just another way of saying, give us this day our daily bread. Verse 9, those who want to get rich fall into a temptation and a trap, into many foolish and harmful desires. We could spend our whole time in this text, but I was assigned Proverbs, so we're going to move along. So let me ask you this question. Are you content? Are you wisely content? The Proverbs teach us that we shouldn't be foolishly greedy, but rather we should be wisely content. There is great wisdom and, in fact, great gain in being content. And then thirdly, are you righteously generous? Are you righteously generous? David Garland writes this in his commentary on Proverbs. The righteousness that we become through Christ's sacrifice, I'm sorry, this actually is from his commentary on 2 Corinthians, I apologize. The righteousness that we become through Christ's sacrificial death works itself out in our sacrificial generosity to others. A lack of generosity calls into question whether or not we have truly received the righteousness of God. Woo. That's some stuff to think about. That's heavy. If we're not generous, it demonstrates that we have probably not recognized how generous God is with us. How generous is God with us? Thank you very much. Really generous, whoever said that. Regan, I love it that you're not even looking this way and you're paying attention. And you're hearing the word of God. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord for that. God is really, really generous with us. Proverbs 3, verses 9 and 10. Honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of your crops. Then your barns will be filled to overflowing, and your vats will brim over with new wine. It's not always the case. It's not a promise, but it is a wise saying that is often true. Honor the Lord with your wealth. If God gives to you, and you give back to him, and you trust him with it, and you honor him with it, he's likely to continue blessing you. Proverbs 11, 24 and 25. One man gives freely, yet gains even more. Another withholds unduly, but comes to poverty. A generous man will prosper. He who refreshes others will himself be refreshed. And that doesn't even necessarily mean that God will give you money if you give your money away. But that old saying, it's more blessed to give than to... There is a great sense of relationship with God when we act like he does. Isn't there? Isn't there something that just does something good in our hearts when we act like he has acted toward us? When we are generous with others like he has been generous with us? We could go on and on about that. Proverbs 19, verse 17. He who is kind to the poor lends to the Lord, and he will reward him for what he has done. Isn't that funny? We lend to the Lord when we're kind to the poor? Well, in a sense, right? Because what God has given to us did come from him. But then he also gave it to us, right? Like when I give a gift to one of my children, and then they choose, let's say at Christmas, and then they choose the next Christmas to take that gift that I loved so much and I gave to them with such, and re-give it as a white elephant gift somewhere else. Guess what? It was a gift to them. They can do with it what they want. When we left California, we gave a whole bunch. I'm not saying any of my children have done that, by the way. When we left California, we gave our bedroom furniture to our eldest son and his wife. And Kathy had built some of that stuff. It was more than just that we were giving to them. And then they sold it and made $300 off it. And you know what I said? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Because it was theirs to do with it in the way that they thought that it was best. And God gives to us. Isn't that a strange thing? That then when we handle it, we're handling it how we want to. And when we give some back to him, according to this passage at least, there's a sense of it that we're lending back to God. That's a weird thing to think about, isn't it? Jimmy Carter once said this: when it comes to generosity, some people will stop at nothing. I'm going to let you sit with that one for a moment. When it comes to generosity, some people will stop at nothing. In 2 Corinthians 9, verse 6, remember this: whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Again, it's a principle, it's a proverb probably, it's a wise saying. It's not always the case, but often it is the case. Pastor George talked to us about this last week, about being generous. Is God generous with us? There is only one necessary thought in order to promote generosity within our own hearts. And it's not to conjure up a feeling of wanting to give more. It's actually a recognition of who gave it to you, of where it came from. If you want to become a more generous person, and I hope that we would all desire that, it's real simple. You don't conjure up generosity feelings. You remember and reflect upon the one who was lavishly generous with you and continues to be each and every day, not just with financial blessings, but with all the blessings, including salvation for our souls, which is of far more important than wealth. Daryl Bach wrote it this way: generosity is a fundamental, concrete expression of love. So who do you love? We're back to that again. Who do you love? Do you love God or do you love money? If you love God, you give back to him. And you give to others generously, just in the way that he has given to you, he has given to us. So are you righteously generous? I hope and pray that you are, or at least are desiring to be. Money, 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 always sunny in a rich man's world. It's not always sunny in a rich man's world. But there are always blessings in the world of the man or woman who knows from whence it came and trusts the giver rather than the gift. God says in his word, when it comes to managing money, don't be foolishly greedy. He also says, rather, be wisely content so that you can be righteously generous. A wonderfully generous Christian was once asked how he could give so much to the Lord's work and still possess great wealth. His reply, "Oh, as I shovel it out, God shovels it in, and the Lord has a bigger shovel." So I say to us, let's get shoveling. We should probably let Proverbs have the last word. Proverbs 11:28, again, we read it before: those who trust in the riches will fall, but the righteous will thrive like a green leaf. Father, we praise you and thank you for this word that is a great treasure to us, an incredible gift that you have preserved, that in it we might know your heart, that we might know your intention for your people, that we might learn how we should respond to you, that we might be reminded by the stories of those who have gone on before us, how they've done it right and how they've not done it right. Lord, would you help us to recognize from your word that all that comes to us, every good thing that we have, every good and beautiful gift comes from the Father of lights, according to James. And Lord, would you help us then in turn to be wise with what you've given to us, to steward it carefully in a way that doesn't build Matthew Funk's kingdom, but builds your kingdom, that we might store up treasures in heaven, that we might be generous with others around us, just like you have been generous with us, that we might be content with what you have given to us and use what you've given to us well and wisely so that we won't be foolishly greedy. Lord, forgive us where we have fallen short. I suspect some this morning are challenged. Change. Lord, would you give us courage to make those changes? Lord, we want to be wise with all that you've given to us. We want to be generous just as you are generous with us. To that end, we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Great. You're welcome to stand. We are going to close with singing the doxology together. We're going to sing it through twice without the amen the first time around. And then you are dismissed for lunch.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
creatures here below, praise him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Go in peace.